They say that an election year is a marathon, not a sprint. But in recent weeks, Tony Abbott's made it seem more like a triathlon. And perhaps his frantic start to the year has the Prime Minister wondering if the opposition leader's gaining on him. First time since the 2007 election loss, the coalition has passed Labor on primary votes. It has 41% to Labor's 40. But after preferences, the government still leads by 4 points.
You've had a good start, mate. Well,
yeah, done. Like it's been okay.
Are you running?
Still a bit scary, but here we are.
Okay. See ya. Pleasure to put this on.
Okay. It's the first anniversary of the government's massive stimulus package. And the Prime Minister was making sure no one missed it. He even attempted to delay question time to mark the occasion.
Patting himself on the back.
The government soon realised that it was a bad look, and after backing down, it fired up.
When I first challenged the Prime Minister to a public debate on climate change, he refused. Saying that the Coalition had no policy. Well, Mr. Policy, Mr. Speaker...
Order.
First time nerves, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, we have a policy which is simpler, cheaper
Order.
And clearer than
Order.
The government. Does the Prime Minister have the guts to have a nationally televised debate, my direct action versus his great big tax?
Yes, and let us have the debate here in the People's House.
We'll have delegations descending upon Australia from all around the world to see the magical miracle cure for climate change from Dr. Abbott.
It doesn't work. It puts no cap on carbon. It lets all the big polluters go absolutely free and doesn't even bother to attempt to fund the policy. It all comes off the back of a leader of the opposition who doesn't believe any of this in the first place. Because if you go out there and publicly say that climate change is absolute crap, what do you think people conclude when you put out a piece of paper that you're actually serious about it?
Malcolm Turnbull told his party room he will be voting for the government's emissions trading bill.
Announcing for the third or fourth, fifth time that it's going to cross the floor, honestly it's going to cross the floor, has no resonance whatsoever anymore. This is a bloke who clung on to his leadership on the argument that the Liberals had to stick to supporting Rudd's plans for a great big tax on the grounds that if they didn't, they'd be wiped out. Well, they're not being wiped out at all, are they?
Well, not on the top.
His judgment is now severely under question, and there's no chance in the wide world Malcolm Turnbull will ever resume the leadership of the Liberal Party, which is now his dearest wish.
I agree with you on the latter point, but it's also got to be said that the Liberals and the Nationals are now at the point where they also have to stick to a leader until the next election. So, you know, this plan is going pretty well for them, but they've got to lock in behind
the
leader.
No, but also the issue itself on global warming has gone down the toilet. And, I mean, I had one very senior frontbencher of the Liberal Party tell me privately that he was in the Malcolm Turnbull camp, that, you know, we can't move, he said, or we'd be destroyed. And he said, no, that was wrong. I mean, in terms of political judgment, it seems that the Turnbull camp was completely wrong, that opposing the ETS actually would not destroy the Liberals, it would make them stronger, and so we're seeing it.
Is losing the next election even an outside possibility for you?
Well, just being very honest about political history, there is no guarantee for any first-term government to be re-elected. Look what happened to the Hawke government back in 1984, the Howard government in 1998.
But both of them won.
Two or three people in 100 changed their vote, then Mr. Abbott's Prime Minister. That's just a fact.
Gillard says that Kevin Rudd doesn't want an early election. Is that your expectation?
I mean, their plans have changed. I mean, first of all, they were threatening us with a double dissolution. Then they seemed to give up on that. My best guess is that there will be an election in September or October. But I certainly think that they are now feeling the heat in the Parliament in a way that they haven't for the last 2 years. They can't explain the fact that lots of people will be worse off, even on their calculations, under Mr. Rudd's great big new tax.
Sounds like you're dusting off the GST scare campaign.
Look, it's a truth campaign.
This is a really interesting point for the government because it's on the back foot about its own scheme and it knows that its strongest suit is still economic management, and that's what it wants the debate to be
about.
But
that's a change in itself, because there was a time where they didn't mind talking about climate change. The cleverness about what the opposition did during the week is that Tony Abbott actually got a policy out there and he got it out on day one, and that changed the conversation.
What he wants to
do,
I think, is make sure that middle swinging voters who think this is a concern want to see something done done about it are kind of covered off, that this isn't a reason not to vote for the coalition, but continue to send the signal to his base, who are largely sceptical, that no, I don't really think it's much of a problem at all. Everything we do, we can justify doing on other grounds other than this ground that we're not really all that sure about. So yeah. He's really not trying for the green, the light green vote. He's really sending this dual message. There is a contradiction, though, in the dual message. He's sort of arguing for something that really he's not sure that he believes in. And I think that credibility issue is sort of the major place the government can go. But at the moment, they're losing the argument on the money.
We have to save Australia again from Mr Rudd's great big new tax.
Is it so simple that it's almost infantile, or that's the way you need to do it? You just need to keep it simple?
It's exactly what you need to do, because essentially it is a great big new tax on everything. It is. And the whole thing was Malcolm Turnbull's refusal to use what was the biggest weapon that the Liberals ever had, and he refused to use it.
You know, these have gone up, these beautiful chops. Yeah. I mean, what better meal is there than these lamb loin chops? And I mean, these have gone up by 5% just in the last quarter. Mm. These are more grocery prices that Mr Rudd hasn't been able to keep down.
Yeah, even something like this has huge inputs associated with electricity, just even just wrapping it in plastic.
Yeah, that's right, mate. Absolutely.
The render crowd has turned up, I'm afraid.
Is that what it is?
Yeah, that's exactly what it is, yeah.
Oh, dear. Yeah.
Hockey looked particularly comfortable with all of that.
It's amazing, those cameras were just there to record what you'd normally see in the supermarket, two people having chit chat.
For those reasons, Mr Speaker, I will be voting in favour of this bill.
Is it embarrassing, though, that he's going to cross the floor?
Well, again, you know, I would prefer that it didn't happen. But unlike the Labor Party, we're not Stalinist about these things.
Malcolm Turnbull's tiny band of disciples spoke volumes on how this debate has turned in just a few months.
I get the sense that he is using his principles to justify his political misjudgment rather than this all being about principle, which is what he would like it to be remembered as.
Do you think that if he chooses to recontest Wentworth, that there would ever be a time where he could return to the Liberal leadership?
No.
Malcolm was always more moderate and more progressive than that party room, and I think it's going to be very hard for him to make any sort of comeback in the future.
Well, as part of Tony Abbott's attack on the emissions trading scheme, of course, he's been out and about visiting some businesses that are going to be hit by higher electricity costs.
What the housewives of Australia need to understand as they do the ironing is that if they get it done commercially, it's going to go up in price, and their own power bills, when they switch the iron on, are going to go up every year. I mean,
Chris, you wouldn't advise a leader to make a comment like that, I'm sure.
Oh, look, housewives, I think Bruce Bilson chipped in very quickly afterwards and suggested, or husbands. Look, most of us do a bit of ironing these days.
I would have to say, I think anyone that would be comfortable with that commentary by Tony Abbott is probably already voting for him anyway, whereas that commentary, yeah, if he keeps making it, is going to land him in trouble with people that might be more what you'd call swinging voters. So I don't think he's doing himself any favours, but hey, look, the best that the Liberals might be able to spin it is that at least you know exactly what he is, because he can't avoid telling you.
Already there's a sense that the party itself is energised by Tony Abbott's leadership.
Yeah, and we need a contest. We didn't want to sleepwalk to a Labor landslide
but
this
hang
year.
On, right there, is that part of the problem? We need a contest. What are you saying? The press gallery want a contest, and
no, I think
that's
the
what they're being accused of, and therefore...
Not the press gallery. No, the public need a contest. You don't turn up at election time with an opposition bitterly divided and the government just coasting to victory. You need a contest. You need a contest of ideas.
In a little tent, oh, and just like the river I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come.
The opposition party room took on the feel of a Southern Baptist revival.
We can win this election.
Tony Abbott has changed the mood of his troops as he relentlessly preaches one message, hoping to change the mood of the nation.
They don't like Mr Rudd's great big new tax on everything. They are sick. They are sick of the broken promises, and increasingly they aren't sure that they can trust the Prime Minister to be fair dinkum with them.
Prime Minister's not a believer, and his line is that Tony Abbott is a gamble.
This man represents a risk to the economy.
And they have demonstrated yet again why they are such a grave risk
to the Australian economy.
A tactic curiously reminiscent of the one the coalition used to hobble Mark Latham.
Marcus, my son.
Hello.
He's bringing me, he's bringing me moral encouragement.
According to you, I'm stupid, I'm useless.
Please welcome the Prime Minister.
According to you.
There he is, courageous Kevin, the man who was going to take the public hospital system over.
Mr. Rudd, I'd like to know how you expect us to trust you, our generation, the ones that got behind you in the Kevin 07. And now you broke promises like the laptops ones and the health ones and all the ones that are important to our generation.
But according to him,
we have about 260,000 computers out there in schools now. Well, you're shaking your head. Can I just say, that is a fact.
220,000.
He said 260,000, I think, from memory.
220,000 in schools now.
But you said the bus would stop with you, so will it? Or are we going to keep hearing that the previous government did this, the previous government did that?
Well, you know, life just doesn't start afresh. You know, there wasn't just a line drawn across reality at the end of 2007. According to you. They're hard judges, but they're fair.
He wants to be bold! He wants to be bold! He will be bold! It's just the states and the territories are holding him back. According to
him, I foolishly commented to one of my staff that perhaps today would be a gaffe-free day for Senator Joyce.
Stupid, you're useless, you can't do anything right.
We're going to hock to our eyeballs to people overseas. We've got to ask the question, how far in debt do you want to go? We are getting to a point where we can't repay it.
We are the envy of the world, but not to Barnaby Joyce.
$850 billion blowouts in the solar panels.
Once again, he's got his trillions and his millions and his billions mixed up.
What could have possessed the judgment of the Leader of the Opposition to have made Senator Joyce a member of the crack economic team of the Alternative Government of Australia?
Well, I have to say, Barnaby Joyce hasn't been responsible for programs that have killed people. That's the truth. That's the truth.
I'm happy to take any questions the opposition want to throw at me today in the House.
Good luck. Who's gonna shave me?
Need this.
I will too, thanks.
Announce that every home that has foil insulation installed under government's home insulation program will undergo an electrical safety inspection. We have live houses that are a potential risk to their occupiers because of the ineptitude of this minister.
Why did it take until this week and three more deaths for the minister to act?
Safety Order. Is an absolute priority for this government. It always has been. The decisions that I've made in the past reflect that, as does the decision I made today.
This minister should resign if he had any decency.
This minister must go.
He has been a first-class minister.
March last year warned of the inherent dangers of installing insulation near electrical cables. The man who wrote the letter says the deaths could have been avoided.
The training was inadequate and the people who were doing the work had literally, I understand, in some cases been pulled off the street.
Poor implementation has plagued a series of Rudd government environmental initiatives.
The solar rebates, for example.
Also got problems with the green loans scheme as well.
Very few have taken it up because it seems there's a logjam in the system.
You know, the fact is that a lot of this stuff is quite old. It's been around for a while, but it just shows you when an opposition gets its act together, it can really start to put hits on ministers, and I think that's what it's doing with Garrett.
Well, I think there's a bit of that. There's also, I think it's a case of this has been sort of dribbling out bit by bit over the months, and it's reached a critical mass. But listening to Peter Garrett today, I was sort of quite stunned because he was giving these long, convoluted explanations of what he and his department had been doing. And at one stage in the parliament he said, look, there's a lot of acronyms in this. It appears as if they were so bogged down in the process of administering this scheme, you know, they couldn't see the wood for the trees.
Or
they
all died.
Yeah, well, exactly.
The big problem here
was that the government had decided as part of the stimulus program to shovel out this huge amount of money. It wasn't Garrett's decision. He was given the shovel and said, get to work. It's a wonder he put any safety things in place.
There was a lot of haste involved in the school building program as well, but there's been no, as far as we know, there have been no deaths.
If you can't manage pink bats and green loans programs, you can't manage the most complex ETS in the world.
It's almost like a variation. If you can't govern yourself, you can't govern the country.
Different departments, though, because the climate change department is separate and it's attached to Treasury. But the point is very valid.
The PM is saying he's doing a good job. But when you think about it, under his watch, the whales are dying, the koalas are dying, the Tasmanian devils are dying, the trees are dying, the rivers are dying, and now people are dying. We're turning ordinary suburban homes into sort of suburban electric chairs, and you think, well, blimey, if he's doing a good job, what's he got to do a bad one?
Front page of the Financial Review yesterday, I did a poll of talkback radio hosts about your personality, whether you've lost the ability to communicate. Paper mache model that's spruiking the same sort of line all the time. And whether you like him or not, Tony Abbott is more understandable than Kevin Rudd. Kevin's up there in the clouds with some of his comments.
We get lots of viewers saying, we preferred the sunrise Kevin Rudd than the Prime Minister Kevin Rudd.
I can't really understand whether he believes in anything. I'll give you one example. It's when the projections came out about how Australia's population over the next 40 years was going to go from 22 million to 36. He went on, this is in October, on the 7:30 report and said,
I actually believe in a big Australia. I make no apology for that. I actually think it's good news that our population is growing.
When that didn't go down too well, he went on the 7:30 report again at the end of January.
That's where the population is going. I don't have a view on that, to be quite honest. This is simply the reality we are now dealing with.
But when you talk about a big Australia, that's what you're meaning. You're comfortable.
I don't have a view on whether it should be 36 million or not.
I don't think it is just the flip-flopping. I mean, Tony Abbott's done a lot of flip-flopping too. There is an underlying sense in the electorate that he hasn't delivered on a lot of the promises, that he does do a lot of talking, that there isn't much action. And, you know, he's looking a bit defensive at the moment, a bit of pressure, and suddenly cranky with school children, looking a bit defensive and resorting to the, but look what we've done with the global financial crisis. Well, they can't rely on that.
They've turned up in an election year spent. And what we're seeing with Kevin Rudd at the moment is early burnout. This isn't his miscommunication. He's almost lost the capacity to think simply. He's trying to do every minister's job.
The difference is actually Tony Abbott.
I mean, he has rattled Rudd. You only have to look at the way Rudd and his ministers are conducting themselves at the moment to realise that, you know, they're a bit worried about Abbott.
Already in campaign mode, and the polls suggest it's working.
Tony Abbott has galvanised the coalition vote. There is a bit of a slide on and a bit of a return to perhaps reality.
I'm very encouraged by the polls. I think what the latest news poll shows is a continued fall in the popularity of the Prime Minister. I think that the Australian people are starting to understand that this Prime Minister is all talk and no action. I think people are starting to understand that this Prime Minister isn't quite fair dinkum.
Isn't quite fair dinkum, all talk, no action. This is the coalition script this year, isn't it?
It is, and I think it's interesting that he's not averse to talking about the polls. He's breaking the orthodoxy in a number of areas the way he's going.
Should Labor really be worried?
I think the hard heads would be starting to say, hey, PM, don't like this trend much. There was a period last year where the coalition was almost coming third in a two-horse race. They're unbeatable, you know, Labor's going to win more seats. Well, now, well, maybe not.
Of all the polls that would worry Labor, I'm sure that Galaxy poll today, specifically looking at federal voting intentions in Queensland, would be a concern because it does put the coalition in front.
And it would probably result, if there was an election held tomorrow, in a loss of about two seats. Emissions trading is more of a problem for people in decentralised states than it is in centralised states. Coalfield electorates and so forth in Queensland are probably feeling some concern about some of the fear that's been generated by Tony Abbott around the issue. There's a lot of seats clustered around the central point in Queensland and in New South Wales. They're going to be the two big battleground states, I think, in the coming election campaign. It's all very well for Tony Abbott to be pushing his base, but is he able to get the support of people in the middle? The centre ground is where elections are won and lost in Australia. And frankly, I think it's going to be harder for the opposition to gain that ground.
On that ETS question, I know you've never been a fan, but if you're in Kevin Rudd's shoes, you can't afford to drop this, to even back away from it, can you? Politically, he must fight for this to the death.
Well, it's like a smelly old albatross for the PM. The government had said Copenhagen really important, must have legislation in before Copenhagen. And the rest of the world went to Copenhagen and they said, oh, we sort of don't care much. And I think a lot of people said, well, hang on, have we been taken for mugs
here? Yeah, but hang on, I mean, John Howard wouldn't have walked away from the GST or the workplace reforms at the first whiff of unpopularity, would he? I mean, once a Prime Minister, you know, draws a line, and they've got to fight for that policy.
No, but you could argue that if the PM was really fair dinkum, you would have a double dissolution on this. But by jingoes, I think enough Australians out there are now raising their eyebrows that they would think, well, hang on, we're having a double dissolution on something that nobody else cares about. It is a really difficult decision for the PM, and I'm glad he's going to make it, not me.
Did you vote Labor last time round?
First time ever.
You voted Labor?
Yeah.
And what about this time round?
No. Back to Liberals.
The near miss happened on a notorious stretch of the Prince's Highway, southwest of Melbourne. The opposition leader had travelled there to campaign for a better road.
We just saw a moment ago how perilous this road could be.
Another potential peril of dodgy home insulation was visibly demonstrated today. A month ago, this Western Sydney home had new ceiling bats installed. Today, the ceiling caught fire.
Mr Rudd and Mr Garrett are still in denial about this. They're in electrocution denial about this.
On the 18th of February.
On the 9th of March.
On the 3rd of April.
A likelihood of death or injury.
On the 29th of April.
Houses could burn down and people could die.
Let's just call a spade a spade. There are problems with the implementation of this program. Shouldn't run away from that.
At some point, Kevin Rudd is going to have to cut him loose. It was a mistake to put Peter Garrett into the environmental portfolio in the first place because he was always going to disappoint those who thought he was a wonderful eco crusader.
Peter Garrett was still a great draw card for Labor at campaign events, fundraising events.
Absolutely.
You wonder now whether he is still that asset for Labor come election time.
Really, these kids they live in the house, or a couple of them do, and the insulator turned up, and then they just jumped up onto the roof and started helping him out, and they're putting the insulation through the trapdoor and...
Yeah, it's not helpful, that footage, that's for sure.
Extraordinary.
I think it needed to be halted.
I stand before you very confident that I have acted properly and diligently, and I'm going to continue to do that in my job as Environment Minister.
And Kevin Rudd's still backing him.
Peter has done the right thing in closing the insulation program.
But it really goes to the whole issue of the competence of this government, and I think it's just a yet another example of the Rudd's inability to manage anything.
This program has demonstrably failed. Who's going to believe them that they have the competency now? This is the danger, I think, the credibility, to take over and run the hospitals well. This government is really in a hole, I think, and if it's going to get out of that hole, it has to start drawing together some of the things it has achieved and start talking about them again.
Well, you said this government is starting to look like a oncer.
I think this government is in trouble.
Morning, all.
Minister, welcome to breakfast.
Good morning, Fran.
Morning. How's it going?
Now, the government is today releasing the counter-terrorism white paper.
No surprise the government's putting the report out today when they've got a minister under pressure.
Terrorism continues to pose a serious threat.
Australian people will see straight through it.
Some of the threat we now face comes from the Australian-born, Australian-educated and Australian residents.
I think the focus on homegrown terrorism in the white paper and in the government's presentation of it is a little bit confected. I think they're looking to find some news peg.
Why are you releasing this document today? The opposition says you're trying to take the heat off Peter Garrett.
Well, that's just not right.
The Prime Minister and his office have deliberately sexed up a national security document.
I understand the Liberal Party today is now saying that the home insulation program is a bigger threat to Australia than terrorism.
The Prime Minister appears to have been caught red-handed playing politics with national security. Sometimes beginnings aren't so simple.
Sometimes goodbye's the only way. The government will introduce new bills into Parliament today.
Yesterday it was the counter-terrorism white paper. Today
A new crackdown on people smuggling.
I need another 200 houses to get rid of the stock that I've got.
I kind of get that. I get it. We kind of get it. We get it. We get it. That we've got a responsibility.
What we saw from the Prime Minister today was a Peter Beattie moment. When your government has got it seriously wrong, you say, yes, we created the mess, and here I am, I will fix the mess.
What have you learned from this?
I think I'm disappointed in myself for not asking more questions. I believe it's now important for Minister Garrett to concentrate on core responsibilities of environmental protection.
He can't even sack a minister properly.
There's no point sugarcoating this.
I think the public are getting thoroughly sick of this kind of political cunning from the Prime Minister, who presents as the Milky Bar Kid, but is frankly one of the most scheming and cunning politicians this country has seen in many a long year. He has accepted that the program didn't work, but the minister responsible for that terrible program is still in cabinet. He's still drawing a full salary, only he's doing a part-time job.
I think that to Tony Abbott this makes a big difference. I mean, Tony Abbott doesn't have a huge amount of money. He's got a good salary, but not a great salary. His wife doesn't have a highly paid job. And I think to Tony Abbott, when he sees that someone in the cabinet stays in the cabinet, even though they don't perform, whereas they might be in the ministry rather than the cabinet, and there's a big salary difference, I think to him that's that sends out a sincere message to him, and he wants to respond to that. I don't think that's just a political point. Now, Peter Garrett doesn't really need the money.
Prime Minister. Leader of the opposition.
I'm not getting ahead of myself, even if others are.
Sorry.
I fail the high standards I've set for myself and the government.
Years gone by and still
I head the government. I'm ultimately responsible.
Words don't come easily.
We need to lift our game. I need to lift my game in terms of delivering.
Forgive me.
The apology began late last week, and by Sunday, the penitent Prime Minister had firmly laced on his hair shirt.
Like, forgive me, forgive me.
We're taking a whacking in the polls now. I'm sure we'll take an even bigger whacking in the period ahead. And the bottom line is, I think we deserve it, both not just in terms of recent events, but more broadly.
Kevin Rudd and his advisers clearly believe an act of contrition was necessary to reset his relationship with the public. Labor has apparently detected a feeling in the community that their concerns about his government aren't being heard. So a moment's reflection and humility was called for. But his weekend ablutions went well beyond what some in his ranks were expecting. While they concede it was necessary to admit the fault in the bedevilled insulation rollout, they believe the government has a strong record of achievement to sell. One said the Prime Minister had overwhelmed the apology and left people with a broad impression of failure that's both damaging and inaccurate. And it means his front bench is being asked to engage in a bout of Maoist self-criticism.
What mistakes have you made that have contributed to that? I mean, does it
you reckon the government's as bad as he said?
Well,
the Deputy Prime Minister interprets her leader's words as raising the bar.
I do agree with the Prime Minister's assessment, and what I believe the Prime Minister is challenging me and other ministers and the government overall to do is to keep improving, keep rising to the challenge.
When all is said and done, the government is still in a strong position and there is no need for it to panic. But perhaps the most worrying sign is that its tight discipline is cracking. Private criticism is becoming more pronounced.
Both major parties' primary votes have slightly improved. Labor's lost just one point when preferences are distributed, although Tony Abbott is on the rise.
I think the problem is that the Prime Minister is rattled by intimations of political mortality.
Was it pretty obvious that he wanted to just cut the whole home insulation thing and change the subject, which it probably was successful in doing? But I think a lot of people would be going, oh, well, you know, we're a bit unsatisfied, but was it that bad?
But the problems are not the way he identifies them. They're nothing to do with him having to work harder. They're nothing to do, really, with communication skills. They're all to do with the fact that he is, in many cases, a very bad policymaker. And he thinks he's a genius. I mean, look at the insulation thing. Anyone who thought you could expand an industry 20-fold in the space of a year and not have problems just knows nothing about policy making.
If you look at it, so much of what he says, it's about, I have to lift my game, I have to do more. You sometimes think that Kevin Rudd does think he is the government, that really everything, I mean, everybody talks about how much of a control freak he is, but all he's doing is reinforcing this image.
I think it's sort of healthy in a way, this stuff, these little cracks are starting to appear for the government, because it was always going to happen. I mean, from day dot when he, you know, he chose the front bench and just imposed his will across the whole place, it was never going to be sustainable. So if it sort of starts these little rumblings, it will help him. But if he takes heed of it, if he doesn't take heed of this stuff, then it could be trouble, and it's down to him, I think.
The time for delay is gone. Funded nationally, run locally. State-run systems will become part of one national network.
Pity the poor patient who gets sick when the Prime Minister has a policy to sell.
I'm doing very good on it.
How far can you get them up? Halfway up?
I can get it all the way up.
Mate, you're a better, braver man than I. Mate, I'm impressed. That's pretty good, mate.
Yeah.
And you were in having surgery only yesterday.
Kevin Rudd went to the healthcare coalface to pitch his hospital takeover plan. The hard sell has only just begun, and he knows he's up against it. At least one premier says the states are only struggling because the federal government's been dropping its share of hospital funding for more than a decade. This plan does nothing to solve the money problem.
We're losing $90 billion of our GST going back to the federal government, then we're getting it back again from the Commonwealth as Commonwealth funding. But there's no more money, so it's very hard to see how we can improve the quality of healthcare with a system that's giving us exactly the same money as we've been getting up to date.
But the Prime Minister's not listening.
It's very easy to go out there and carp and complain and criticise, and I would suggest that those who are out there just whinging and moaning about it, they should basically get with the program.
The charm's being saved for the people using hospitals rather than running them.
G'day, I'm Kevin.
Hi.
Julia Gillard, everybody concedes, is the star performer of the Rudd government. She's now been wheeled out to defend these announcements. Why have you allowed yourself to be dragged into the defence of what is a hastily cobbled together so-called reform package?
I think this is a great plan, Alan, so I'm very happy to talk about it.
This is, we've got the wrong person running the country. I will say to my listeners, this is a woman who has nothing to do with health care, and she is the Minister for Education and Industrial Relations.
She couldn't possibly agree.
She's looking very demure there.
She's too early for that, isn't it? It's too early. It's only the first term.
Yeah, I think it probably is too early for that. Although some people are clearly thinking about the Prime Minister setting the reset button, doing repentance, going to redemption. Phil Currie, how did he do?
Oh, he did it right. Everyone finished the week talking about him and his policy, at least, you know, and in a generally positive, or at least a constructive way, compared with the way they finished last week, talking about insulation and Peter Garrett. So, he got the agenda back on his own terms, and Tony Abbott helped him by sort of, you know, being out the back of nowhere, sort of lost for a week. So, sort of Rudd seized the stage.
He was just completely missing in action during this quite important week, I think it really sort of stymied the opposition's response.
Miss Abbott, good on you. Just put the satellite phone off because I'm going to be talking to Brian. Thank you very much.
Mr. Abbott.
And no, that's the stove, but turn that off too. And
Mr.
the
Abbott.
Fridge. Put them in the truck.
Mr. Abbott, where
Truck's
are you?
Truck's the one with the wheels.
Where
Sorry,
are
with you?
You,
Brian. I'll go a beer when I get out of this. I'll tell you that for nothing.
Mr. Abbott, where are you?
Out in the outback, Brian. We're out in the outback.
Who's there with you?
Nobody's here with me, Brian. This is just man against the elements out here. I beg your pardon? Have you got a press pass?
You're a bit lucky, aren't you? I mean, we nearly lost you the other night.
Oh, it's just a flesh wound, Brian.
But it must have been worrying, very worrying.
Well, you know, cometh the hour, Brian, and...
Cometh the text message.
point I'm trying to make here, Brian, is that fortunately I was perfectly okay. It was a, you know, nasty, rather anxious moment, but fortunately everything's okay.
But you did send a text message, didn't you?
Tried to send a text message. We couldn't work out how to do it.
Mr. Abbott, did you have any idea where you were?
No idea at all, Brian. We were completely lost.
So what did the text message say exactly?
Well, it just said that we were lost.
Whereabouts?
Fossil Creek. Lost near Fossil Creek.
It's lost near Fossil Creek?
Yeah.
Well, how did you know you were near Fossil Creek?
I could see fossils, Brian.
And obviously a creek.
And a creek. Yeah, bush skills, basically. Basic bush skills, Brian. I mean, either you've got them or you haven't. Unfortunately, I have.
Who did you send the message to, Mr. Abbott?
I could only remember one number, Brian.
Oh, your wife, obviously.
No, I didn't want to worry my wife. No, we needed help, Brian. The position was pretty desperate.
000.
No, couldn't remember 000, Brian.
Who'd you call?
Contacted my press secretary. First things first, Brian.
Mr. Abbott, are you aware that Kevin Rudd has announced a $30 billion plan to fix the public health system?
Has he?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's not publicity, Brian. This is publicity.
Mr. Abbott, thanks for
Hang
your
on
time.
A minute. Stay still, everybody. Some sort of
what
a
is
buffalo.
It?
Hang on. Is I got him.
Kevin Rudd's apparent rudeness towards the New South Wales Premier on Friday has now been contrasted in the newspapers.
There's an obvious contrast. Kevin Rudd is close to Anna Bligh. They are friends, even though the state government is causing some trouble for Labor. I think they're worrying about the impact that's going to have on them federally.
We see this very much as a historic opportunity. We're very pleased the Commonwealth have taken this step and see the discussions now and up to COAG is very productive.
Yeah, well, let's get on with some health reform. Okay,
right.
Guys.
Thank you. Look, that is bad behaviour. Yeah, there's no way that is an accident.
But the danger here, I think, is in the headline, which is the two-faced headline. If that grabs in a more general sense, I think there's a danger. I mean, we've got a prime
minister. It does grab it in because there is already this sense of the prime minister being a bit snaky, a bit bad-tempered.
I mean, I thought that looked like Kevin listening to the explanation on the VIP flight of why his meal was
exactly late.
Or the wrong meal. All that stuff comes flowing back, and this plays very badly with women. They think it was an appalling act of ill manners.
But also in policy terms, I mean, we've got a prime minister here who, you know, says the ETS is the greatest moral challenge of our time. Copenhagen falls to bits. He comes home, pulls the doona cover over his head, and we don't hear about it anymore. You know, he talks about cooperative federalism, which is what this is meant to be about, and then behaves like a junkyard dog.
He likes the Broncos, the Prime Minister. Yeah, despite that, he's still getting the boos from the crowd.
Interesting. Hometown.
Yeah, well, the hook I didn't understand.
This pragmatic jostling is well underway to decide who will be Julia Gillard's deputy when she replaces Rudd sometime after the next election. Has it really come to that? Personal ratings, though in decline, are still historically high. He's still comfortably in front, two-party preferred.
People are thinking, well, he might win, but he might only just win. And if he does only just win, does that make him sustainable for a second term or a third term? Now, if we go back and we remember, Bob Hawke only just won, John Howard only just won their first elections. They went on to be very successful. So history tells us these
talk
things
about the longevity of their leadership during the first term, and
that's what's
different in this case. And as Laura pointed out, that I think she said that he's absolutely unloved within the party. And when we saw earlier the treatment of Christina Keneally,
I think that's always been known about him, that he didn't have a political friend base, if you want, like, or even factional base, really, that he was locked into.
Therefore, I think there's a structural issue here, and it's this. The only way that Kevin Rudd got to the Prime Ministership was with the support of the New South Wales right and Julia Gillard's numbers in the left. Mm. Now, if Julia Gillard's numbers in the left get pulled out from underneath him, he's gone. Mm. He is gone.
And from the very beginning, people were saying, not necessarily that Julia Gillard will make a move anytime soon, but I wonder when she'll make a move. From the very beginning, it was always on.
I have to say that I love Julia more than I love Kevin. Now, that mightn't be a lot, but I think she's an improvement on Kevin.
I'm not sure that helps.
On International Women's Day, Tony Abbott has undergone, as he described it, an evolution in his own thinking.
To change is to grow, and to mature is to have changed often.
The Coalition's paid parental leave scheme would give mothers or fathers 6 months off. Most would still receive their full pay. It's more generous than Labor's plan to pay the minimum wage for 18 weeks, but that's taxpayer-funded. The money for Tony Abbott's scheme would come from big business, a 1.7% levy.
Come on, come to the big scary man.
The Greens are on side.
We've been outgreened by Tony Abbott, and gee, it hurts.
And the government sees its first big opening to hammer away at Tony Abbott's character after weeks of being on the back foot.
Pointing out that in government, he had a very different take.
Compulsory paid maternity leave over this government's dead body, frankly.
This comes back to credibility. The Leader of the Opposition said he never believed in it, now he does. He said he'd never increase taxes, now he will.
Was this Tony Abbott's Medicare Gold moment? Mark Latham and Julia Gillard announced the Medicare Gold policy at their policy launch. For a few days everyone said this is an election winner, it's going to rock the socks off of the voters everywhere. Then people started to think about it, and their immediate reaction was, this is too good to be true. And Labor's polling showed that their vote among certain demographics dropped like a stone and never recovered.
Homosexuality, how do you feel about that?
Oh, I probably feel a bit threatened.
It challenges, if you like, orthodox notions of the right order of things.
So it's just that whole concept, as much as it is a problem for him, of social values, he just keeps feeding it.
I don't want to give away confidences here on the program, but here you go. I don't think this has got to do with social values. I think this has got to do with Tony's experience in the seminary when he was a trainee priest. And I think...
You think that or you know that?
I know that. And that, you know, what he saw there and, you know, what he felt...
Completely about, separate issue, of course, Glenn.
Well, I think he was speaking in a personal sense. I think he was speaking in a personal sense.
But isn't that the problem? I mean, Tony Abbott should either not answer these questions or find a better way of answering
that
them.
That is, show me a man's strength, I'll show you his weakness. I mean, it is a strength that he answers those questions honestly, but is it a political weakness? It can be.
It's a real skill, this walking backwards business, isn't it?
He said himself that he didn't contest the leadership after the election was lost in 2007 because colleagues had said two things to him. One, that he was too hard line, and two, that he was too close to you.
Well, I don't know whether colleagues said that to him or not, but I wouldn't have thought being close to me was a liability. I had won four elections.
He's very cunning, and I think that cunningness shows, and he can see an issue and he can grab an issue. And how does he handle it? He gets right in your face. He exaggerates, he grabs the headline, even if he knows that the next day he's going to have to back that off. Good example is the accusation last week of a bribe to Channel 7 with a reduction in the TV licence fees. The word bribe appears, it gets the headline, it creates all the atmosphere. Next day he doesn't actually repeat that. He just says, it doesn't look good, let's go on. But he's played that role
Tony
out.
Tony has altered the political scene. There's no doubt about it. There's no disrespect to anybody else. But if you don't recognise that, when you don't recognise anything about Australian politics.
So no disrespect to Malcolm Turnbull, but Tony Abbott's doing a better job.
Mm-hmm. I think he sees in Tony Abbott the best chance of his legacy surviving.
Yes. How do you see the upcoming election? Tony Abbott's told his troops they can win.
Oh, look, if Tony Abbott ends up the Prime Minister of Australia, I mean, you've got to say, God help us. God help. Truly an intellectual nobody. And no policy ambition. You know, I mean, is that all there is? You know the song... Is that all there is? I mean, is that where we'd be, really? He turned up in the last couple of years when I was Prime Minister. I always regard him as a sort of resident nutter on their side.
He's a very physical kind of guy. We see him on our TV sets night after night. They're in the speedos, they're in the swimming pool, on the surf. But there's one part of his body that doesn't get much exercise. And that's up here, Mr. Speaker.
So what's going on there? Why are they just so honed in on Tony Abbott?
They must read in their own polls, because this government won't do anything without checking with a pollster first, that Tony Abbott is a polarising figure. And they want to accentuate the negative.
Kevin Rudd has wanted to talk about little other than his plan for hospital reform.
Everything go okay?
Yes, brilliant.
Today, Tony Abbott was goaded into a fight.
Does the Leader of the Opposition support this plan or oppose it? Well, the Leader of the Opposition remains stoically silent.
If he wants to give me leave, I'm happy to speak on health and hospital policy in this Parliament.
Leader of the Opposition.
I move standing orders be suspended, as would allow the Leader of the Opposition to speak about health and hospital reform.
Tony Abbott hardly needed an invitation to launch into a blistering off-the-cuff attack.
I was a better health minister than anyone on the other side of this
minister.
Parliament. And the former boxer landed his punches.
What a fraud!
Order.
What a phony! What a complete fake this Prime Minister is! What a disgrace to the great office!
It's good to have Mark Latham back.
Mr Abbott says he questions all of Mr Rudd's public hospital funding plan and opposes much of it.
In other words, give me a fence to sit on for a few more weeks, a few more months, wait to see where the weather vane turns.
If his own Labor premiers don't trust him, why should I trust him and why should the Australian people trust him?
But the government couldn't get enough.
I move that the Leader of the Opposition's time be extended by 5 minutes.
Don't yawn, Prime Minister. Answer the question. Don't stare at your notes. Listen.
The whole routine was supposed to be about the sort of rope-a-dope exercise, I guess, and draw Tony Abbott into the thing. Did it work out that way?
Well, I think he actually acquitted himself pretty well off the cuff.
He was given extra points because he was caught on the hop. He had no time to prepare at all.
And that's when he's at his best, when you snap him to attention. He may not be so good on detail when he has to prepare.
He needs a much fuller policy. I wouldn't be surprised if before the election the Liberals moved to try and outflank Rudd again by lifting from his 60-40% split, saying, well, what about a single funder? That would be a big, bold, radical game changer in that debate.
This is what Abbott wanted to do when he was Health Minister.
He did. He Howard tried many years. Howard would never let him.
Howard didn't want him to do this because Howard wanted the states to keep wearing the political odour from running public hospitals. I think that's one of Abbott's problems, in that these reforms that Rudd's put together probably go by and large the right way, but they're base level reforms.
Good afternoon and welcome to the National Press Club for this unexpected pleasure.
We'll see how the worm judges the head-to-head battle.
I'm at a terrible disadvantage in this debate because I'm not capable of waffling for 2 minutes the way the Prime Minister is.
Having a first-class healthcare system is basic to the Australian fair go.
The Prime Minister has had some medical experience as an anaesthetist in the House of Representatives. But look,
that line went down like a bomb.
Let's work together on how we build a system for the future.
I tell you what, Kevin, you stop telling lies about me and I'll work constructively with you. That's a fair deal.
What I constantly hear in Mr. Abbott's responses is this ocean of negativity. What Mr. Abbott did as Health Minister was take $1 billion out of the system.
Mr. Rudd asks for me to cooperate with him and then he tells blatant lies about my record. It's just not good enough, Prime Minister, but it's so typical of you.
The worm takes a dive.
The Prime Minister was clearly scripted. His staff or himself had learnt how to tweak the worm.
71% to the Prime Minister.
I don't think there's been any Liberal leader who the worm has liked.
I thought the Prime Minister sort of won by sort of a half-cooked worm.
They're like two little boys fighting over a lolly, and I don't know how you can tell who's telling the truth.
The debate was given saturation coverage.
Ran right across the country.
But it's hard to say how important picking winners and losers is when most of Australia was at lunch.
Did you know that was on? No, I didn't.
The Prime Minister caught everybody, including his own colleagues, off guard when he announced the debate.
The people watching today were some journalists at the press club, some people who turned on television hoping to watch Days of Our Lives, and then TV tonight was sort of all about the worm, not a lot about health. It's a funny old debate. It was almost Tony Abbott came out boxing, throwing sort of lefts and right, and the Prime Minister came out ice skating.
During each Abbott attack, Kevin Rudd stared straight ahead, avoided eye contact.
They never really met on the battlefield.
Julie Gillard and Tony Abbott debate every Friday, and there anything goes.
I know that he's given his bathing cap away to charity, and this is the anniversary of the end of work choices, so I've brought him and in a very new
I've got a
bathing
present. I've
bathing
got a present for
you,
a Mark Latham Julia Gillard memorial press release. Another boat, another policy failure. There's been 100 boats under you, 100 policy failures,
and there are 90 people being prosecuted for people smuggling.
No, we're talking about the people smugglers and whatever. Don't be alarmed by this, but have a look at the Brisbane Sunday Mail headline this morning. They're here, the boat people are here living among you. They're out there
Shopping,
aren't they, some of them?
Yes, it doesn't get much more evil than this. They're in Brisbane shopping.
When will you get your head out of the sand and realise your policy on illegal boat people isn't working?
That they're taking the place of others who are doing it the right way. I reckon that's what the average Australian gets narky about.
And I know something.
So do I get knocked
okay,
about it as well.
Okay, well, why don't you do something about it? What are you going to do? Pacific Solutions seemed to be a better policy.
Even before Tony Abbott took to the water and started the triathlon this morning, he was the splash in some of the newspapers. So worth putting this in context, right? If 90 minutes in the water, then 7.5 hours on a bike, and only then does he start to run a marathon, 42 Ks.
I know. Most people would put it down to madness. There's a cheap pop psychology view that this is Tony Abbott's form of flagellation, scourging himself for some sins unadmitted, at least in public. But I think that's too cheap and nasty.
You wouldn't hold to that at
all. I wouldn't mention it even.
No, wouldn't bring it up.
Look, I did an interview with Tony Abbott on this issue for a column I did, and I put to him that aren't people going to be worried that you're more interested in getting fit than being fit to be Prime Minister? And he made two points. He's always been interested in exercise, and he doesn't spend so much time that it precludes him from being with his family or his work. The second point he made was, look, there's only a handful of federal politicians who are known generally in the population, through his bicycle escapades and his budgie escapades, he's now one of that handful. So
when you're in opposition, you've got to work from dawn to dusk. I frankly can't understand how he finds the time.
And what I saw this week in the health debate was a Prime Minister with a plan versus Tony, who's a fitness instructor with a bit of attitude. Now, the reality here is Tony...
That was a bit of a low blow, Julia.
Tony was...
I'm in awe of what he does physically. I mean, that is a great body he's got, and
don't you reckon there might be some Tony Abbott floats at the Mardi Gras this year?
I can't see how it's going to hurt him, particularly when he's up against, quite a boring technocrat in my view in our Prime Minister.
I can recall John Howard and his green tracksuit and those sweaty walks around Kirribilli and
the Walk of Life
around Hyde Park in London or wherever he was at the time. I don't think he either won or lost elections because of it. And neither will Tony Abbott. It's got nothing to do with the price of fish. At the end of the day, Tony Abbott got the job, improved the Liberals' vote because he put the Liberal base back together. Yeah, Turnbull fragmented it. Tony Abbott was always going to put the Liberal base back together. Now, you've got to do more than that. You've got to add on to that to actually win an election. He's not doing that at the moment. He seems to have stopped a bit. I don't think the debate helped him at all. It was pretty obvious that he lost it. But then again, he should never have agreed to it. You don't go into a debate without a health policy, you're a sitting duck, and that's what happened.
Tony Abbott swapped Lycra for a suit to start to put some mental muscle behind the coalition's push for government. There's no underestimating that task.
Running for government is tougher than running an Iron Man.
That's because there are only two places on the political podium, first and last, and today's news poll showed the coalition faltering. All the early promise evaporated. The coalition's primary vote has fallen 3 points to 38%. Labor's backed by 56% of those polled to the coalition's 44. If that was repeated at a general election, Labor would pick up another 13 seats. And on the crucial measure of who's the better economic manager, Labor's surge past the coalition. Economics was Tony Abbott's topic of the day, and he planted himself firmly in the Howard Costello tradition.
For 9 years, I was a minister in the Howard government and thoroughly absorbed its economic ethos.
But the surprise of the speech was his reassessment of the government's hospital reform plan.
I question all of the policy and I oppose much of the policy.
It seems the negative reaction to Mr. Abbott's performance in the leaders' health debate has him singing a different tune.
The coalition will not necessarily oppose the government's public hospital changes.
After a fortnight where health was front and centre, Kevin Rudd has again surged ahead.
I think the public actually get it.
The Prime Minister's personal standing has bounced back towards 60%.
Another problem Tony Abbott might have hoped was neutralised is Barnaby Joyce. Last week he moved the National Party Senator out of the finance portfolio because of a series of gaffes that damaged the coalition. But if he thought that meant that Senator Joyce would rein himself in, then he was mistaken.
These people actually do read the Productivity Commission reports. I use them when I run out of toilet paper.
There are key sections of the public service that are becoming politicised.
Maybe if they burn down enough houses, we can reboot the economy by building them again.
So on the very day the coalition leader was trying to rebuild his team's economic standing, one of his shadow ministers launched a series of attacks on the government, which are likely to rebound.
Senator Joyce, you haven't had a really great month, have you?
Oh, look, it started pretty well, Brian.
Well, you were the shadow finance spokesman at one stage.
Yeah.
You used to be an accountant.
I'm an accountant, Brian. I know something about it, can't have that. There are certain things I'm allowed to talk about. I've been asked to confine myself to a couple of things. I made a bit of a list of them.
These are the things you're allowed to talk
about?
Yeah,
these are the things I've been encouraged to confine myself to.
Your portfolios?
Where?
And now the man who dreamed of being Prime Minister is walking away after only 5.5 years in politics.
I think Malcolm is probably the nearest thing to a Renaissance man that the Parliament has seen in recent times.
One Liberal wit today described the rise and fall of Malcolm Turnbull as the 2020 cricket version of a political career.
And you're not going back even if Tony Abbott lost the next election?
You think Tony Abbott might lose the next election?
No, I've no idea.
Jeez, that'd be terrible, wouldn't it? Wouldn't that be shocking? Tony lost the election after all he's done.
What were the pros and cons for you leaving Parliament?
Oh, yes, good question, Brian. A fair choice I had. I could remain on, you know, as part of the coalition.
As part of the team?
As part of the coalition.
As part of a party you disagree with?
Well, who disagreed with me?
Well, what I mean is in key aspects, you disagreed with party policy, didn't you?
Yeah, the party policy was only developed in order that it would disagree with what I wanted, though, Brian.
Yes.
In order to disagree with me, this is how they tipped me out.
I've recommended the Governor-General the appointment of Tony Burke as Australia's first Minister for Population. Many Australians have legitimate concerns about the sustainability of different population levels in different parts of the country.
A government which has lost control of our borders is no fit government to give us the infrastructure we need to sustain the population of 36 million, which Prime Minister Rudd has just glibly endorsed.
We do not have a target of 36 million.
It's not a target, it's just a projection. Under Mr. Rudd, we do not decide who comes to our country and the circumstances under which they come.
I think there are some dangers here for the opposition of trying to pull an election slogan from 2001. Here we are with asylum seekers, and once again, they chop and change depending on what they think will get that day's headlines.
Today I want to announce that the government is implementing an immediate suspension on the processing of all new applications from asylum seekers from Sri Lanka and Afghanistan.
This is an admission by the government that its policies have failed. This is no solution, it's just an election fix.
Supposed to be a deterrent for other Sri Lankan and Afghan asylum seekers. I mean, apart from being legally improper, this is morally abhorrent.
But I don't understand why you would freeze particularly applications from Afghanistan when we actually still process applications from countries like and have accepted refugees from countries such as Bangladesh, Pakistan, why Indonesia?
The government argues it's because security in both countries is improving.
Someone's claim for asylum is not legitimate, they'll be sent home.
This is pure politics and yet one more lie from the government on an absolutely botched boat people policy.